Redemption arcs have been a staple in fiction for as long as fiction even existed. Sometimes, it's nice to see the bad guys find themselves repenting for their crimes in one way or another, but there are moments where the bad guy realizes the error of their ways and tries to change for the better. So today, let's talk about redemption arcs and why they're kind of weird. Disclaimer, this is all just personal opinion and my own analysis. Redemption arcs are like the twist villain storylines and provide essentially the same goal, showing character development through strong emotional changes. It's nice to see a character that was previously an antagonist turn a new leaf, especially if that character isn't actually a villain or a bad person, just misguided or misunderstood. Redemption arcs usually happen in two ways. Either it's a character-based redemption where the character themselves have a personal epiphany about their life that makes them realize how bad their actions are and they want repentance. Or it's a story-based redemption, where instead of the character themselves having that epiphany, it's actually the plot or the story's themes that make it so they're now an ally rather than an antagonist. Plot-based redemption doesn't always mean a change of heart, just that their roles change and so does their relationship with the main character. These aren't mutually exclusive, of course, but I'd like to think about it as where does this redemption come from? There are actually multiple ways in executing redemption arcs because it's dependent on the character and the setting they're in. Stories that focus more on optimistic, emotional growth, and individual realizations usually do the redemption arcs in moments where the character realizes the error of their ways through a powerful event. Stories that have a more realistic or grittier setting take time and usually have a slower progress. All in all, redemption arcs are meant to be multifaceted and catered to the character in question. Now, what I actually want to focus on are three specific kinds of redemption arcs that really stuck with me, and some that I found interesting because it shows how different stories can handle this kind of thing. Number one is redemption through compromise, where a character has no choice but to ally with a protagonist, but doesn't really lose their villainous or immoral traits. This could be because of problems that the character can't solve on their own, or a personal epiphany that questions their life morals. But the ending of this is that the character doesn't retain this good relationship with the protagonist after the problem is solved. Just a civil, don't breathe in my general direction and I won't be a problem. The story is what quote-unquote redeems them by recontextualizing the relationship, as well as forcing them into a situation where they need to change, but not necessarily their personality or even a want to change in the first place. One example of this is GLaDOS from the Portal series, a cruel, conniving, but intelligent and unintentionally charismatic artificial intelligence from the Aperture Science Laboratories. GLaDOS's purpose is to perform numerous human tests for the sake of science. So, human experimentation, yippee. When we first meet her, she talks to our protagonist with a Siri-like approach, guiding us through unsuspecting test chambers and occasionally giving us praise. In the first series, she's almost nothing more than a guide. It's up until the end that we slowly realize that the facility we're in is completely empty, and that GLaDOS had killed everyone with neurotoxin. After defeating her in Portal 1, circumstances lead us to the sequel, Portal 2. We meet a robot named Wheatley and attempt to re-escape from Aperture Science after we were pulled back into it. However, because of unfortunate circumstances, we reawaken GLaDOS, who is now even more vengeful towards us because of how we ended her in the first game. She becomes sassier and more cruel with her jokes, attacking the character personally, but retains her testing protocol and forces the player to go through the usual set of deadly puzzles. She keeps this air of dominance until the player and Wheatley challenge her and ultimately win. However, when Wheatley replaces GLaDOS, he begins to show signs of corruption, eventually betraying the player and throwing them 6,000 feet under. It's during these moments of vulnerability, of not only being stripped of her power, but also learning about her true origins, that she slowly learns more about herself. She also forms a kind of hesitant friendship with the player, helping her defeat Wheatley and even becoming slightly more empathetic to the player's situation of being trapped, lost, and misguided. In the end, GLaDOS returns to her position of power and inevitably, after a speech, lets the player go. We don't know if she became more human or was simply letting the player go because you were too much of a bother, but in the end, there is a civil relationship between GLaDOS and the player where if you don't come back and kill me, I'm just going to let you live your sad, pathetic life. Second is redemption from realization, where the character realizes their past transgressions and makes an active change in their actions and even personality. This is the redemption that we're used to, where a sorry shifts the character to the better path after months of self-improvement. It's the feel-good story from the bottom up. If you want an antagonist-turned-friendly classic, look no further than one of my favorite redemption arcs ever in cartoon, only second to Prince Zuko from Avatar. Now, I was going to add him to the list, but I think you already know this guy's a king of redemption arcs, so I want to focus on someone else. Instead, I want to focus on Peridot from Steven Universe. She begins as a classic antagonist, cruel, cold, conniving, and someone that treats humanity as nothing more than insects. She first appears alongside the Homeworld Gems, ready to watch the destruction of Earth. However, after her spaceship crashed and she was abandoned on Earth, she was inevitably captured by the Crystal Gems and slowly learns the beauties of the planet, through very, very rigorous moments of vulnerability. And even then, she still struggles to understand why the Earth is so precious and valuable. So she has moments where she questions the authenticity of the Crystal Gems and has to fight against her own homeworld ideals, namely that Earth deserves to die. However, it all culminates into one beautiful moment where she finally lets her true opinions of the planet shine when she is finally given the one opportunity she had to go home and abandon this planet.
You are to leave the cluster to grow. It will tear apart the Earth, and I will take immense satisfaction in erasing that hideous rock off of our star maps. Is that clear?
I won't do it! I can tell you with certainty that there are things on this planet worth protecting!
What do you know about the Earth?
Apparently more than you, you Claude! Peridot, out.
And even after this moment, Peridot takes a lot of time to accept that she is now a traitor to her homeland, making her have to compromise against literal years of indoctrination and where she finally becomes her own person. I love Peridot. Third is unspoken redemption. There's some characters that aren't necessarily evil personality-wise, but were put in the antagonist role as an adversary. The story redeems their role into a pseudo-ally, while not necessarily redeeming them in a traditional, oh, I'm sorry kind of scene. The difference between this and the first one is that the character is palatable enough that they could almost easily blend in with the good guy crowd without actually going through the moral epiphany normally associated with redemption arcs. It's literally just a circumstance that brought them into the antagonistic role. One example of this is Tartaglia, who played an antagonistic role in the second arc in Quest of Genshin Impact, but slowly transitioned into a hesitant comrade of the Traveler across the years. Tartaglia started off as a power-hungry warrior, but had an amicable enough personality for those that he deemed as either innocent or not really enough of a threat to his goals. Tartaglia, while being a weapon of war, is still a relatively chill guy who operates as the lowest in the organization's food chain. It's not to say that he isn't dangerous or powerful, but rather he feels more connected to the civil citizen versus other distant higher-ups. So when he inevitably comes back, it's not like we have to completely feel uneasy around him, even when the Traveler does. He just casually forms a good relationship with the Traveler and naturally acclimates into being a pseudo-friend. You know, a trust of, I'm not going to kill you, you're not gonna kill me, let's go get a cup of coffee. Well, they're certainly close enough that his family knows about the Traveler and that his family actually feels more safe with the Traveler being in Tartaglia's presence. Now that's what you call a good friend. Tartaglia's redemption is stranger than the previous examples, because we never actually got a sorry for what he did in Liyue. He never vowed to change for the better, hell, he never really changed as a character besides that he's in a different light now, and he never really lost that bloodlust. But the story was what kind of redeemed him in a sense of transitioning him from a clear antagonist to a reluctant supporting role, so a redemption arc can just be as subtle. Now, are these examples good? That's up to you to decide. But writing redemption arcs take time and a complete understanding of the character's limitations and potential. You can't expect a story to be the end, but rather the beginning of their journey. My problem with redemption arcs isn't their magnitude, but their questionable mishandling because it's either too forced, rushed, or you get a whole new character altogether that you don't even know. Not to mention, some shows use character arcs way too much. why I think redemption arcs are not only in a peculiar place, but also kind of overrated, is because it becomes a game of two extreme ends on how a character is written. Either you're redeemed and join the good guys, or you perish a swift death because the good guys always have to win. It's a weird duality that just rubs me off the wrong way if you mishandle redemption arcs and its relationship with the main story. Number one is redemption arcs that change the character's personality altogether. Some stories fail to understand that redemption arcs doesn't mean a character is completely good, especially if that character has a lot of baggage or negative personality traits that need working on. But some fail to do that, and they become watered-down versions of themselves to adhere to the status quo of what a protagonist is supposed to be. For example, some characters that are cunning, snarky, and intelligent become dormant and passive because their previously challenging personality traits were associated with villainy. So now, you've lost a core component of the character that made them interesting in the first place. Because redemption arcs are some of the most, if not the most, difficult arc to pull off because you're not only renegotiating a character's entire personality, perspective, and future progress, but also how the audiences see that character. So mishandling their redemption could mean completely reducing that character into something generic because you're not ready to actually compromise their ally status with their questionable personality. Number two, redemption arcs that try to erase the consequences of a crime. Just because you redeem someone narratively doesn't mean they can just be absolved of all of what they did, or even just not be criticized for what they did. And it doesn't even have to be in the eyes of the law. Some redemption arcs force a character to live with their sins rather than get the mercy of death. Punishment can be internal. Granted, might not be as vindicating as justice, but it can get the job done. Some characters are forced to live with the knowledge of what they did and actively have to do good as repentance, and that usually includes putting themselves in uncomfortable positions. But this point is very, very subjective, and punishment is depending on what the character actually did in the series. And not every audience member will forgive a character, and that's perfectly normal. You don't need to make them suffer, but you also don't need to act like it never happened. It's a slower process of self-forgiveness and maybe even retribution. Number three, redemption arcs that happen too often. Redemption is a great thing that should not be constantly used as a cop-out, because one, having too many sympathetic villains and antagonists can create predictability, and even worse, talk no jutsu eras. This can reduce the stakes of your story by God knows how low, because there will be some moments where we need the satisfaction of beating up a bad guy, but we're supposed to feel bad for them because they're not so bad. So, for this one, I believe that redemption arcs should be spaced, sentimental, and sparse. Number 4, the unfinished redemption arc. This gets a very special mention because there are rare cases where we're supposed to feel very sorry for the character and the arc is actually working. But no, they're actually just scum of the earth and somehow becomes even worse than when they started because we got a taste and hint of logical character development all for the character to regress back. This not only undoes probably months of writing and hard work, but also convinces the audience that hey, this guy is an irredeemable monster. Number 5. Redemption as the end. One of the worst feelings in the world is when the redemption becomes the end of the character, and they eventually get written off the series because their main arc is done. Rather, I believe that the story in a redemption is the beginning of their story. It's so much more interesting to see the character have to negotiate their past, have to say sorry to people they've hurt, and even change their own antics to show authentic change. And maybe even the hard parts about redemption, where it doesn't always work out, where you won't always get your I'm going to fix everything moment, where you're living with the worst version of yourself and the only way to walk is forward. Redemption arcs are best done when you treat it as a midpoint and show the slow progression of a character and how they become a better person fixing their wrongs. Because that is the most human thing that you can do for a character. Because everyone makes mistakes. Maybe not felonies, but mistakes. And that's it. Anyway, my name is Aster and thank you for chilling with me. Bye-bye!